many people will know me still. I used to be a different character to what I am now. You know what I mean? I'm a man who grew up in Tottenham, North London, and used to be on the Broadwater Farm. Everybody on Broadwater Farm knows me still. You know what I mean? Everyone used to know me as Marlon Brando back in the day, right? So we used to be on the other side of the tracks doing all kinds of other stuff. We won't get into all of that now, but it was a life changing sort of experience, and it was a combination of things, really, of me realizing that I was more powerful than I was, and that I could do more than what I was doing, and I wanted more than what I had. And that made me leave the streets and realize, you know, especially when I saw a lot of people were, at that time was when the crack was big time. I saw a lot of my friends, a lot of people just cracking out, and all kinds of things was going on in Tottenham at that time. And I even went and got baptized. I got baptized and everything like that, and started everything again, basically. And it was a Bible that my sister gave me. My sister gave me a Bible. This Bible was the African Heritage Bible. Okay. So it's a big leather Bible, basically. Yeah. But and it's the King James version of the Bible, but it breaks it down from a black perspective.
Yes.
It was written by some clergymen in America, black clergymen, priests, something like that. And it shows you all about, this is where I first learned about Kush and the Kushites. And then that instigated me to go and research and learn about the Kushites and learn about the Nubians and the whole of, you know, African history. And you know, the whole purpose of me, that even that name again, was to uplift the name Kush, what I gave to my company, was when I realized that I was a king. I was once a king. My people were once kings and queens. And it was to remind people that we were once kings and queens. And that's what the whole Kush film stands for, that we are, you know, we can be whatever we want to be.
Let me just get that. So then, in answer to your point, then, it's that self-belief. It's just that belief that you have in yourself, and the energy that you've actually put forward has built the brands.
We all have it. We all have a power. You have it. And we all in this room have a power.
Yes.
What's happened is we are distracted by all the noise. So if you see me try to distract us back to what we're talking about, it's because that's the noise I'm talking about. I never watch the news. Mm. I never talk about celebrity stories. I'm in the industry, big time. Film, TV, music, sports. I'm in the industry, but I'm not in the industry, if you get what I'm saying.
Because you're really selective about what you give your energy to, right?
Exactly. I could be in a room at the biggest award ceremony in the world. Or I could be at the Grammys, but I'm not there. Mm. So you're greeting, you're not greeting Jordan. I ain't there. I'm back at home. You just saw my body. You didn't see my soul. And people have to understand that, because we do live in the world. I'm not saying you can't go to work, but you can go to us. I was speaking to my little sister yesterday, and she has something at our workplace. I said, understand something. I'm not saying don't go to work. Go to work, but don't get your soul sold to becoming work.
Yes.
You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. I could be at work. It's robotic. It's really robotic for me. When you're driving, it's robotic. Drive, robotic, right? But the thing is, your soul is somewhere
else. It's still traveling.
Your mind too travels. There's times your mind goes daydreaming. Your mind too travels.
Oh, so you had a point?
A question. So when you was like 16,
yeah,
what is it you said, I want to be?
When I was 16, parents wanted me to be his lawyer, right? What I wanted to be is I wanted to launch companies. So when I got into a position that I could launch a company, I launched it. And mine is kind of the same as Marlon. When I was at uni doing a law degree at the final year, I decided to write 90 letters and send it to 90 companies to find out what company was going to hire me when I graduated. I told them I just graduated with LLB Law Hunts. I was in South Bank University. Every single letter came back saying, unfortunately, we're not giving you the job. So I decided to start Invincible there. And my clients were everyone in that university. And Invincible started as a magazine, radio, and a TV station. It started as a media company, and it started at the university. Mm. By the year we came out, we had about 500,000 people. But the reason I called it Invincible, because at the time, I wanted to think about something that would never be destroyed, right? That would never be destroyed. But that came to me from God. I cannot take credit for that because I only Googled and found out the meaning yesterday properly. I knew what the meaning was innately, but I never, it's weird to me, as it's weird to everybody, that I never even, for 18 years, I didn't try to find out what Invincible was. Only because I was coming to this show, and I've done so much. I've done CNN, I've done so much. There was a reason why.
Yes.
I went to look up what Invincible actually meant, and that's a funny thing. It's a funny thing, but it shows you that your power is not you. Your power is your soul. You know, the you I'm looking at right now is your body. It's your body.
So let me spin that back now, because obviously what triggered all of that was going back to young Trevon, right, and the question he asked about branding, things like that. Now, I've been here 19 years now. Now, I've seen many come. Yeah. Many black businesses come. Big. Some of them get big. Some of them making a lot of noise like that. They're not here now. They're gone. The people that are still here are the ones. It wasn't just a business for them. It wasn't just about branding for them. Oh, what about marketing? It's that energy. It's they believed in what they are doing. Yeah. There's something more to than just, oh, I want to make money out of black people. I just want to make money out of business. This is why we're still here today. This is why I'm still here today. Because believe me, the industry that I'm in, the film industry, I could have been walking down the road now with some two-something thing like a madman. You know what I mean? Because believe me, this industry actually helped me big time because, you know, I took up personal development 11 years ago through this industry because I was getting angrier and angrier, becoming an angry black man because every door I just thought they were locking me out. They were fighting me. Sony Pictures tried to rob me one time. Mm-hmm. You know, Lionsgate Pictures tried to rob me one time. Now, I'm from the streets of Tottenham, from North London, from Border Farm. I've got to go and look in the mirror and say, "What? I'm a bad man. These white people just want to blatantly rob you and tell you, say, go away or something like that."
How do you mean rob you? Like
rob you? Where they, you know, with Sony Pictures, you know, the market manager called me up, told me that they want me to work on a film for them. Blah blah. This is what's the dance film? Step up.
Yeah. I think it was Step Up 2 or one of them ones.
Want me to work on the film, blah, blah, blah. Go and have meetings. Go to in Sony's office with them. Went to a couple of meetings.
Yeah.
What happened is now they then find out there's this guy that does this dance. He does a dance event. Yeah. I forgot the guy's name now. He does this street sort of dance event. They found out about him. But there was a PR company found out about him. Their main PR company, they started going whispering to them. So next minute, they start, you know, inching away sort of thing. So basically, they took my idea and then they went and just went with this guy because he already had the event kind of going. And they jumped into bed with him and then told me, they didn't engage me. I've had all the letters and everything, all the emails where they're telling me to go on. I came up with a competition which I was going to do down at a club in Wood Green.
They're trying to pimp your idea. Take that and then run off with that and just run me.
Did you get back your money? Listen, this is Sony Pictures you're talking about. So I would have to be taking up legal proceedings, take him to court and all that kind of stuff and like that. Listen, they blow me out of water within a week.
You've got this event.
All I could go down is go down there and so want to box up people and do but that's my Sony Pictures, you know?
And they got police and they got security and stuff.
And you're the angry black man.
You've got an event on the 25th at Regent's.
This Wednesday, the 25th of October, down at Regent Street Cinema, just on Regent Street there.
Now, why I think that's so heavy is the film is about, it's a biopic of Thurgood Marshall, who's the first Supreme Court Justice in America. African-American Supreme Court Justice in America. When I saw it, I'm like, I was drawn to it because it had, I've forgotten his name, Mr. Bozeman.
Chadwick Bozeman.
I saw his face and I'm like, what are you doing with Chadwick Bozeman?
And also Sterling K. Brown is in it. Sterling K. Brown, the guy, he was
he's getting a senior moment. Yeah,
exactly, you're right. what's his name again? American football player, bad guy. OJ, the black guy who played on the prosecution side, the lawyer.
Yes, he's
turned a very big actor now. He won an Emmy Award recently, recent Emmy.
But that film, I saw it, so I didn't know. I just saw Marshall because they didn't call it Thurgood. They just called it Marshall. So when I've seen it, I was thinking it was a police thing. So I've hit the button. Then I'm like, wow, biopic, Thurgood Marshall. Yeah. Definitely checking that out.
Yeah, it's powerful.
It doesn't have a lot of national press, does it?
No. Again, this is the same company, Sony Pictures.
Mm.
And I've been bucking head with them for years. Mm. For years. I even said, they don't really chat to me anyway. Because I told off the CEO a couple of years ago about this.
You still got the film, though.
Because they have to respect me. It don't matter if they don't like me or not, you know.
Yeah.
They can't get rid of me. I'm a voice. They respect me at the end of the day because I've been here 19 years doing what I'm doing. So a lot of these film companies, some of them, yeah, you know, Marlon Palmer, he's got a big mouth or whatever, always the typical black man who's got a big mouth, but they have to come to me if they want the marketing to think. There's no one else that does what I do in the UK. That market is cornered at the end of the day. And it's not only that, it's that they know, when they look, I've got the audience for it. I'm in a West End cinema, packing it out, doing big film screenings. If I go to them and say I want the film, they know they might as well give it to him because he's going to give us some money back, you know what I mean? And the film is going to get the publicity that they're not giving the film.
Why do they make the film and then it's not getting that, or does it market's not big?
Because no, you've got to understand it. Again, it's business as well. Sometimes we don't understand business as well. So, but to me, it's not always good business, but it's business as well. Because at the end of the day, you've got to remember, when they make a film, for instance, the film has different marketplaces. Mm-hmm. So, and this is worldwide. So you have the European market, you have the North American market, you have the Asian market, things like that. They make their money depending on something like that film maybe costs what, 15, say 20 million if it may cost. They can make that back in America alone. So everything else is surplus after that. So in the UK, what Sony Pictures is known for this, and you know, because my job, you know, I do distribution, and that's one of the key things I'm focusing on now, distribution. Mm-hmm. So I study all the patterns. I know what you know the box office is for certain films and all that kind of stuff. So Sony Pictures has got a trend of picking up certain black films, and I said I had a big argument about this, about the film No Good Deed with Taraji P. Henson and Idris Elba, because they did the exact same thing with the same film. And what they're doing over here is that they release in America, do what they need to do, they will do some market in America, because right now in Marshall in America, Chadwick Boseman and the director Reginald Hudlin, who I'm in conversation with, are doing all the rounds and doing Q&As and doing all that kind of stuff in America. But I tried to talk to Sony about bringing the director over, Reginald Hudlin, and they said they're not spending any money bringing no talent over, blah blah blah. So that didn't happen. But what it is, obviously, look, if they don't spend no money on marketing, simple, they don't need to recover no money on marketing. Everything that they, when they put the film in the cinema, then everything that they make then is just profit, basically, because they've not spent any money on marketing. So what they do, they have a strategy of leaving it in the cinema for a longer period of time. So then what it is, people start talking about it and it becomes word of mouth, and then they just they depend on the word of mouth, and they make, so there's an average amount they might make about, in the UK they make maybe 300,000.
Right.
They're happy with that, basically, on top of whatever they make.
Okay,
elsewhere.
They're happy with that.
Yeah.
I don't know who's the producer and the director that decided to bring this story to
Reginald Hudlin is the director of the thing. So
are they happy?
Yeah.
Are the directors and the producers
No, they're not happy because I've been talking to him and I've told him what's going on. So I've been corresponding with him, but even though he kind of messed me up. And this is why sometimes us black people, I tell you, we don't support one another properly, because I was telling him what's going on over here, and I said, you know, this is between us, and next minute I'm getting a call from Sony saying, oh, you're talking to Reginald Hudlin, and they're telling me, oh, don't worry, we're going to send you the poster now, because I was complaining that it's only a few weeks ago and they still haven't sent me a poster yet, still haven't sent no trailer yet for the UK. Well, so I was letting him know what's going on, and he went back and obviously must have complained. So
it's like particularly happening for like black films, because it doesn't seem like, to me, it don't seem profitable. Like, if you make a film, you want to bring it out and make as
As I said, they've made their money in certain markets, so they probably, and you got to understand, like, we're seeing it from our point of view, from a black perspective. They're seeing it from a white perspective. It's the same way you was talking about earlier on about, I mean, this is you guys calling them black films. These, a lot of these films are made by white people, yeah. Mm, but yeah, with black faces
in
it.
We just mean that the story,
or they're black stories, yeah, really, but it's made by white people. So yeah, we want white folks to
make a film,
right,
and
make
market a film,
and tell it how we would tell it,
yes,
and for them to have that understanding of that.
You're getting somewhere. That's the thing. I know. We had the same conversation when we talked about education. How can you give your children to them and expect? Okay,
you're right.
I'm just confessing this out right now. I'm still hoping for big things with Black Panther. I'm sorry.
No, that is a whole nother level.
I'm still hoping for big things,
and that is not really. It's the difference between Black Panther now is that it's not Hollywood. It's Hollywood in a sense, but Marvel has come and just shaken up the whole game and just changed the game. And Marvel has got power.
Tell me, because I'm saying the way that the Black Panthers come out, way that character is.
Have you seen all the black? Have you seen all the black people in the film? No, the majority of the cast is black, and then
I'm trying not to get really excited because sometimes you get shot in the foot.
No. But obviously they have to follow. Remember, this is not all new. This is comic book. This is history.
Yeah, because these are things that have been written historically.
These stories have been written, so they have to follow what's going on. Okay. They're going to try and bring it up to date and things like that, but it's the stories already been written from, you know, and obviously Marvel, the writers of Marvel, they wrote these stories in those times in the 60s when there was Black Power.
Remember the X-Men?
And all this was going on, yeah.
So, like X-Men, Brother Hakim, who's going to be with us next week, who does the film breakdowns and whatever, was talking on how the X-Men is actually Martin Luther King and Malcolm X. Yeah. That's who exists. Xavier and Magneto are. That's the two different sides. That's what they were writing about.
And you know, these white guys are writing in the time of, you know, when it was cool, when everybody was in their offices, police, you know, smoking a little spliff, and it was all cool, and one, it was all love, you know what I mean, all happy sort of thing, and being black was cool sort of thing. So it wasn't the racist thing wasn't there as it was later on in the set, in later times and before that as
in
well.
In terms of the way that they were allowed to write the stories.
Yeah. Well, in a sense, yeah, but I don't think there was. It was just a group of guys who were sitting down writing these stories. It wasn't. There was no control. There was no one over them controlling and saying, "Oh, you're going to write it like
that." So does
that
mean
you're
expecting big things from the Black Panther as
Absolutely.
Well?
Absolutely. I mean, from what I've seen already, from what I understand, look, if they've taken a young guy, right, Ryan Coogler, he's only made what, two films?
I think he's like 31.
Two films before that, basically, Fruit Road Station, and then
that's directed it.
And then he tried to the Rocky film. First, yeah, you know what I mean? Exactly.
Yeah. So they're big films, though. They're both
this
big
is
films.
A multi-million pound budget film, and they've given this film to this young black guy. Wow. They must have a lot of faith on him, and they've given it. Listen, when you saw this, did you see the new trailer that came out last week?
Yeah, I did.
I saw it. Yeah, you made me watch it. I saw it a few days ago.
You don't hear the music that they put to it. I'm saying, did they let them put that music to it?
Tell me what the music was. I heard it, but I can't remember.
You mean it's Jill Scott Heron track that
the revolution will not be televised.
And I'm saying, I'm saying they're getting deep with this. White people are going to be up in arms. Some of them white people. I said, well, this is going to be.
You know what? I saw it, and now you've reminded me. But at the time, it's just goose pimples. I'm just watching the thing, like, and the part of me's like, hold yourself down, brother, because you know that these people, they give you that, and then in the end of it, they just, you know, they go make him get beaten up by some little 7-year-old Caucasian lady.
This film's going to smash. I think it's going to break records next year. I know that.
That's amazing. The whole concept of the thing, and if you're not aware of what this Black Panther film is about, or the story, or the concept of it,
black superhero,
who not only is he a black superhero, he's a black superhero who has his own country, has his own natural resources, has full control of the best natural resources in the world, and as far as the Marvel Universe is concerned, he's kind of undefeatable, isn't he?
Well, yeah, and it's not even that. It's what they're showing in the Black Panther is that they have technology. It's in Africa, they have technology that the white folks don't have. Yeah. Right? When you go there, it's like it's flying ships, cars, and the technology what they got. So imagine these are white guys who sat and wrote this in the '60s. You know what I mean? It's on a whole another level.
Imagine the young children who are watching this now. now. Of when course, we talked about the mindset that you get from just freeing that mind, when you get to sit and just see something like that in pictures, it's amazing.
It's different. You know what it comes to mind as well? I was thinking about, you spoke about it quickly in terms of some of the films that come out, you know, the slave films and that. And I think you touched on it in terms of when we look back sometimes. And I remember I watched the film Detroit, a few months ago, and that I came out of that film depressed, like there's no hope for us, like we're just in a powerless we're in a powerless position.
I'm fed up with seeing those films,
and you know what it is, it's like I think there's a part of me that kind of feels like, okay, the history, these things happened and the story should be told, but at the same time it's like you need those kind of empowering kind of representations. That's why that's what the main thing about the Black Panther. I remember I watched the cartoon that they did.
Yeah,
the animation is not the slickest animation I've ever seen, but just that representation of like a black character who's strong, and to watch that, that's like wow.
Yeah, do you know what,
it's empowering.
And the thing is, but what I want to get to, because I don't want us to give too much credence. I've got Diff Brothers giving me the eye here. It's that we could actually no, because I, you know that now,
nothing wrong.
Ever since I met Jordan, I'm checking myself now because he makes me check myself. He's right, like, yo, am I doing it? Am I strong enough?
Am I strong enough? I'm in a good way.
Yeah,
that's
a good way. Did I not tell you that this brother has a positive effect? No, because it's like, that's right, Black Panther and whatnot. But as you said, we're calling them black films. We don't we're not actually making them. We don't actually own them. If Black Panther was the new Nigerian blockbuster, the world is a different place, isn't it? But it's like we don't actually own those things. So in terms of us getting to from where we are to a place where we can say we take charge of the business side, and if we want to tell the Marcus Garvey story or whatever story we want to tell, we can put it together, market it to our own, and make that successful. Between the two of you, what does it take for us to get there?